Okay, so Phil moves up one. He's going to get involved in the fray. And pay special attention to the range rules. In this case, there, he doesn't have any real targets to select, so I'm not going to get into that real heavy. Maybe the next time I encounter that, I'll cover that. But one thing to note is that even though El Cholo is right in front of him, or even if Phil was over here, he'd still have line of sight to this first room. Even though technically it is at an angle, remember line of sight is nothing but parallel to the board edges. However, keep in mind that the zone is one large area, okay? And since it starts from here to there, it's more about being from one zone to the next, okay? So you got this zone and that zone. They are not really at an angle from each other. They're straight away. Plus, there's an opening. Now, granted, I mean, the opening's over here, but I mean, since they're not very specific in where you're at in the zone, I actually really like this rule. It keeps things very basic. You don't sit here and go, okay, well, I'm going to put him in this corner of the zone to make sure that I'm straight, you know. It makes things pretty cut and dry, and this makes this game move along. Now, this is only taking some time for me because I'm explaining everything, but you know, later on we do more battle reports and gameplay, you'll see that the game moves very fast. So Phil's going to go ahead. He's already used one action. He's going to fire one square away to that zombie. And I'm just going to throw two dice in case he misses. Nothing wrong with some overkill. In this case, he did miss. He missed once. And he hit with a 5, and that's going to take her out. And that brings Phil up to 2 kills for the game. So we're still in the blue danger zone for everybody. El Cholo has got the lead. Is tied with Phil for 2 kills. I believe Phil has 2. And I can't really tell. You got to be very careful with the pointers and make sure that they're right on. Because of the width of each individual deal there. So anyway, player turn is over. Let's go over to the zombie turn now. You can see where all the noise is at, basically. I wasn't very good at putting noise counters down. Wanda here, and she attacked Mealy, which is silent. He shut off around. You know, there's all kinds of noise over here. It's not that big of a deal right now because all the zombies are over here. Now, had there been zombies over here, you'd have to be a lot better about the noise counters and line of sight to be able to figure out which way that these guys move. Okay, that's very critical. I see later on when we get into a more complex mission, you're going to see how that comes into play. Zombie turn. First is attack. There are no zombies currently alive that have the ability to attack. Yes, so that's cool. That's due to some pretty good playing on my part, if I may tap my own shoulder, and also some good rolls. And to be honest with you, you know, starting the game off with El Cholo might be a touch on the heavy side from a balancing aspect because this tutorial is supposed to be pretty basic. But oh well, you know, I bought the game so I could kill freaking zombies. And El Cholo so far is pretty damn good at it in the early rounds, so I'm gonna use him. Screw it. Yeah. So anyway, first phase done with the zombies. Attacking, can't do it. Next is move. One. These two guys stumble forward. One. This zombie can choose either way. They're both equal distance, and they both have an opening. So I'll go. Actually, interesting. It would be in my benefit. Oh, no, it wouldn't. You can't see that deep into the building anyway. So, and I had to choose between the two, honestly, the rules don't state it, but I would just roll off. Actually, the rules do talk about splitting the zombies, so you might actually end up having to throw another zombie in there in that case. I don't know. I don't want to spend the time looking up the rules, so this video is already going on quite some time, and I didn't intend it to. Which is fine. So if you're still with me, you know, congrats on joining me and hanging in there this long. I'll give you some sort of a, I don't know, a congratulatory patience award. So, yeah. Zombie turn, not done. Now it's time to spawn. So let's go ahead and turn this up. We're still in the blue phase. That's one zombie. So now, things are starting to get a little dicey for Amy here. She wants to hold down that corner. You know, this is where in solo play, you know, it's a little bit different. If we were, you know, two people playing together, you know, you would control two of the survivors. I'd control the other two, I believe. Or is it three? Or if we had another member. Now it starts to get dicey. Because, you know, as a solo player, you really have control of every single player. I may actually change that as I play the game, and you know, maybe give them a rolling chart for their behaviors. Like when somebody gets in danger, you know, what do? I don't know. I'll think about it. So anyway, zombie's turn is over. We're now to the player turn. I need to keep this thing moving along. Amy gets to start first, which is pretty cool, because she's got somebody to kill. So, yeah. So she's going to go ahead and she's going to use her crowbar just for giggles and grins. You know, she's in melee. Yeah. 1 point. Ooh, hit and a takedown. So I think she's got her first kill. Yeah. And that's only 1 point, or one action. She gets one free move. You know, I'm going to be bold with her. She has the taste of blood. If you look at her character, she looks like a pretty evil chick, man. and in the fashion of her background, she's going to charge forward foolishly. And that's a free move, by the way. And she wants more blood on her hands, man. She's tired of these zombies. You know, she figures instead of sitting back, she needs to attack and keep this spawn point locked down. So she's going to do it. She's got two more actions left. Now, remember, she had a free move action. So she's going to go ahead and use that crowbar, since it's the same statistics really as a pistol except for range. And she's going to hope she's going to knock both these guys down, see if she can be a badass. Oh, she misses one, and she, so that was a five on the other one. So that's going to take one of them out. And one remains in her zone. And, yeah, so she may suffer some damage here. Unless somebody bails her ass out. This is where the dynamic of solo and team play comes involved. Because if you don't got your teammates back in this case, next turn she's definitely getting a wound. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. So yeah, Amy's turn is now kaput. Had she had another point available, she could attempt to move out. However, you'd have to have quite a few points because you got to slip free of the one guy. I'm not going to cover that. It is in the rules. I'll cover this stuff as we encounter it. So yes, next is El Cholo, my man. You know, I could be nice and go save her and see what happens. But I kind of want you to see what happens when somebody gets a wound. So, El Cholo, you know, he's got some bloodlust as well. And, you know, he's pretty much the leader, I would say, of my party. He's going to charge forward one. And then again, one. So he's moved up 2 points. And he gets one die per machete, one final point, and he's going to attack this freaking zombie. And he's probably going to take him down. Oh, he bolos with double snake eyes. Epic fail. Oh, can I get a burrito? Good God almighty. Yeah, so that shows you the game, you know. that's how she goes. So epic fail. He runs forward in a fit of rage, cussing and swearing and flailing his machetes all about, and completely doesn't do any damage to the one singular zombie that's in the room. Classic. So have no fear. He's got some support, so that's fine. His turn is through. Phil is next. Remember, he only has a melee weapon, or a pistol. I think you can actually use the pistol as a melee. I don't know. I don't think a pistol whip is going to count as, you know, as one. I'm not going to play it that way, just because I don't think it's realistic. So he's going to go ahead and move one space. Yeah, he's going to move one space. That takes up one point. And he now can see the zombie. He's one away. He's in range. Now, remember, I've got a choice here. You know, he's got two more points to give, which would be basically two shots. The thing is, the range priority is going to put one wound on that, on him first. So, you know, either way, he's going to get a wound. So I'm going to leave that be. And just go ahead, and it'd be smarter to move forward one and use one die to shoot at him. Ah, what is it with the snake eyes, man? Another zombie skull. Fail twice. but have no fear. So now his turn's over. Wanda's up next, and she's got a choice. She can either try to go prevent a wound from occurring to one of these guys, or help Amy out over there. And I kind of wanted to leave that over there to show you, you know, her getting a wound. Don't think. Actually, where's my wound cards? Right over here. So we'll leave it be. And she can move two, so per action point. So she's gonna move, boom, right in there. That's one. She's got two points to spend left. She's got now. Keep in note, she's got a pan in one hand and a fire axe in the other at the ready. However, these are not, you know, dual wielding equipment. You know, so I believe the way the rules are written, you know, she's got to choose one of these to use, and obviously she's gonna use the fire axe. Primarily because of it to hit is 4+. And the frying pan sucks. You got to get a 6. So she's got two shots to take out the zombie and be a hero because of her quick speed to the two guys closest to the objective. Oh! And what is it with the epic fails, man? Double threes. I mean, it's amazing. This is one lucky ass frickin' zombie. It's nuts, but I love it. That's part of the game. Had this been a very large scenario, I'd have been, you know, a little irritated right now, but it is what it is, man. You got to plan for that. Remember, I was pretty aggressive with Cholo. I charged him in. So I could have played conservative and hung back and given myself the best opportunity and played the math to try to get out that zombie. But instead, you know, I got some bloodlust in me, and it took off after him. So. Yeah, so the dice gods are not being very good to me. So their turn is over. It is now zombie turn. So let's go ahead and see what happens. First phase is attack, and we have two scenarios where a zombie can attack a survivor in their own immediate zone. So first we'll do Amy. When they attack, and they're allowed to, I got one zombie, one survivor equals one wound. There's no rolling. It just happens automatically. That's it. So Amy gets a wound card. That goes in her inventory, like such. And I believe as well, she has to choose which one of her items gets taken away from the zombie, I believe. Since I haven't suffered so many wounds, I'm going to recheck that just to make sure I'm correct. But I'm almost positive, because that forces you to then run around and find better equipment. I really have a few choice cuss words right now. Search. You know what? This video is going too long. Move. Oh, that's because this is player's turn. Zombie's turn attacking. Shite. Let's look down here with the wounding. You know, that's a pretty basic question. Yes. The survivor receives a wound card, which is put in place of the lost equipment. Oh. Each zombie within the which is on the zone of a survivor snatches, if possible, a piece of equipment the survivor is carrying. The player who controls the survivor chooses the item and discards its card. In this case, she's going to discard the crowbar. And that's done. This would be basically in the discard pile. Put at the bottom. And the survivor receives one wounding card in addition, which she did already, which is put in place of the lost equipment. Which is interesting because she had that at the ready, so that's where the wound card goes. Had she had more cards, she'd had to spend a point to shift her inventory around. Okay, cool. So, actually, yeah, that's how that goes. So she's got one wound on her. Remember, the survivors have two wounds to take before they die. So, yep, she's bleeding. She's cut. The next attack in this zone over here. Basically, the players would then choose who gets, you know, the wound allocation. Since nobody's really got a wound, you're probably going to pick somebody with an item that you don't care to lose. So Wanda's going to go ahead and take the wound in this case, and she's going to give up her crappy frying pan and take a wound. So pretty nice. I got some wounds allocated here, but everyone's going to probably live through it. So this is going to work out well. Next is movement. We're done attacking. No one else left to attack. Now, it's safe to say that obviously, you know, this zombie who has got some dinner on his plate is not going to move out of the square. That would just be stupid. So even though that's pretty strict about the phase, I don't think that the zombie moves out, even though the next phase is movement. So it probably, if they're, because they're going toward the source, right? Remember, there's noise here, there's noise here. So this guy moves, this guy stays where he's at, movement's done, that's it. Next is spawn, and we spawn and get zero. So that was actually pretty lucky for Amy. And they're done, okay, so that's it. Back to the survivor's turn. First player is El Cholo. So now let's go ahead and hit the other rule, which is escaping the grasp. That's what I call it. But basically, in order for El Cholo to move this room, he's going to have to spend a point to basically walk away from the said combat of this area. You can think of it however you want, but it has a cost associated with going through the player's zone. So El Cholo is going to do that. You know what? Forget that. Because he's just going to walk in, take the objective, and the game's over. Let's let Ocholo kill. Man, let's let him kill this zombie. He's a madman. He ran in there. He's not then all of a sudden you go, oh, I think I'll be tactical and go take the objective. He's got two machetes. Bam. Four and a two. The four is a hit. Dead zombie. Cuts that head off. And, so that's 1 point. He's got two more points left. One, he moves in, and he can still be the hero and take the objective with his final point. Scenario finished. So, that's the opening tutorial. I would say don't base your overall feeling of the game on the opening tutorial until you get a better grasp of the rules. I think some of you hardcore gamers are going to go, oh man, that's just way too basic. It was, you know, it was designed to be easy. So don't let this be the determining factor of how fun the game is. Look at it for its possibilities. You know, it went well for us, but it could have went bad. I could have played, you know, a little sillier. If I wasn't playing solo, you know, don't forget the human involvement here. You know, I know for a fact that if I was playing with one of my Google Plus buddies, would have been like, you know, I'm not going to help you out in that case. You want to be the idiot and run in there? Well, you know, this is about survival. So, you know, the thing is that with this game, you have to act as a team. Yeah, there's going to be times where you can kind of go own somebody or be, you know, a solo dude, but you're going to die. You know, people are going to be like, all right, fine. Keep in mind that while if you're going to run around and just shoot things left and right, causing all this noise, and if you're not going to die, well, then you're going to be killing things. And when you're killing things, you're going to move everybody into the next zone. So now when things spawn, it's going to get twice as bad for you. So you got to choose when you're going to start making noise. And when you're just going to... You'll see. So stay tuned for the next episode where we're going to cover the next... mission or scenario, which is city blocks, and we're going to have 9 tiles, which is going to be kind of interesting. I don't know how I'm going to be able to show you all that with my camera, but we'll give her a try, and hopefully it won't be too zoomed out for you not to really see what's going on. So hey, hope you enjoyed. Do me a favor, you know, even though I'm sitting here having fun, this does take a level of thought, and it takes some time and effort on my part. So, you know, show me that you appreciate. Subscribe to my channel to keep up with future updates, you know, and give me a thumbs up. And, hey, leave me a comment and tell me, you know, hey, you loved it. You appreciate it. You know, you're going to tell people about me, and that's why I do this stuff. So that way, because I guarantee you there's somebody this very moment, well, maybe not on a Sunday, unless they got it yesterday and didn't open it, but... there could potentially be somebody this very moment who's sitting here struggling over the rules. Maybe not smart enough to realize they can go, you know, search the forums and yada yada to get the clarifications. And there's not a whole lot of information out there. So unless you're a board game geek guy, you'd know that there's a forum where people are posting stuff. On Cool Mini or not, there's another place to go. But in YouTube, I'm not seeing too many videos just yet, so I'm hoping to be, you know, one of the first guys to put some stuff out and help everyone out. Because honestly, that's the reason why I do this channel. I do it to share, and that's what this is about. You know, there's been a lot of videos recently, or people talking about the quote unquote community. Okay, I'm not going to use that term, but I like people. And I'll say I like certain people. So, should you prove to be worthy of me liking you, I'm perfectly willing to help you. If you're going to be an asshat, then, and you know, everyone in YouTube, you know who these people are. So, if you're going to be like that, then, that, you know, that's how I'll treat you. But anyway, so get the word out, comment, like, subscribe, and let's have some fun. Let's do some painting tutorials. Let's have a general place where we can all go and talk about this really friggin' cool game. Maybe, you know, people come up with some advanced rules, maybe some more in-depth character development, and we can just go ape wild with this stuff, man. We can have fun. Let's do maybe an online campaign. We can go crazy. So I plan on just having a crap ton of fun with this because, you know, hey, I spent some money on it, and I'm not just going to stick it up in the closet and let it rot. I really believed in this product, and I believed in the core mechanic. As being more than just a beer and pretzels game. Now, if that's what you want, fine. It's got that element. But if you want it to really be fun, I mean, we can take it to the next level. So I'm open to any suggestions. So peace out, everybody. Take care. See ya.